Good evening. It's good to see everybody tonight. We're glad that you all came out tonight to enjoy this great program. We're excited to have Ryan here with us and his associate Bob. They have a lot of information they're going to be sharing with us tonight and through Wednesday evening. So if you're able to come Monday through Wednesday night, they'll be here with us. They do have a large display of a lot of books and different things to look through. Make sure that you do that. Before we begin our service this evening, there's a couple of announcements. We do want to pass along the announcement that Donna Wall passed away this past Monday, April 12th. Please keep Chuck and the family in your prayers at this time. There's going to be arrangements for a memorial service at a later date. So we'll send that out once we have that. But please write Chuck a note, call him, pray with him, pray for him during this time. Matthew 7, verse 24 says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house upon the rock." If you would please stand, we're going to sing our first song, "The Solid Rock."
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. His covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Our Heavenly Father, wonderful Lord, you are our rock. We look to you, Father, for the foundation of all the things that we believe, that we trust in. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be together once again tonight to sing praise to you, to remember what Christ did on Calvary's cross, to hear another message from your word. We pray, Lord, what we do would be to your glory and honor. Give us the boldness, the courage this week to go into the world to tell someone about your Son. The great gospel message. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please be seated. James 4:8 reminds us, "Come near to God, and he will come near to you." This next song is a familiar hymn that reminds us of that fact, that we need him not just every day, but every hour.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour, in joy or in pain. Come quickly and abide, or life is in vain. I need thee, oh.
The next song we're going to sing tonight is kind of a new one here that we've been practicing every once in a while. I personally like songs that are written from Scripture. It helps us to memorize them and remember them easier. This next one's called Galatians 2:20. It comes from that verse where it talks about we have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. Our next song is going to be Amazing Grace. And during our evening service, like we do during our morning service, we offer a time for those who may not have an opportunity to partake of the emblems this morning. We give you that opportunity tonight. We have disposable communion cups that contain the bread and the juice. If you would like to go and grab one of those in the lobby, we're going to sing Amazing Grace, and then we'll have a communion devotion, and then we'll partake together, those who would like to partake this evening.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but shining as the sun.
As we come around the table, let us focus on what Jesus did for us. If we turn to 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit." Jesus didn't have to die for us because he was perfect and did no wrong. We should be dying for him because we are imperfect and sinful. However, because Jesus died on the cross, we have the hope of eternal heaven and the option to follow him. Jesus said in John 6:53 through 58, "Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks blood, my blood, has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day, for my flesh is the real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, and whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." With everything going on in today's society concerning disease and our earthly body, it's very easy to get caught up in the present. However, the hope that we have in Jesus should reassure us that this earth and this body are only temporary, and that his sacrifice gives us a way into our one true home, heaven. As we partake in the Lord's Supper, let us not worry about the uncertainties of today, but focus our minds on Jesus, selfless sacrifice that gives us hope for our future. Let us go to God in prayer. Dear God, we just want to take this time to remember what your one and only Son did for us, died on the cross, so we have the hope of eternal salvation. We just want to take this time and partake and remember what he did for us. We just want to pray in your Son's name. Amen. Let's have a moment of silence. To focus our thoughts on tonight's offering, I want to start by reading a scripture in Acts 20:32-35. "Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourself know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, 'It's more blessed to give than to receive.'" So these scriptures here are pretty much saying that giving is not only a blessing to the receiver, but because they are in need, but it's even more of a blessing to the giver. I'm sure we can all recall a time where we have been on the receiving end of a gift. It made us feel good knowing that there were others out there who cared about us. But now think of a time where you were a giver. How did it make you feel knowing that you were helping others? I'm sure that feeling that you felt good to know that you were helping someone else. Now Jesus has given us the biggest gift of all, the hope of eternal salvation, by dying on the cross. So right now we have the opportunity to give back to the Lord as we are commanded. We should not be giving these gifts out of compulsion or for bragging rights, but we should give joyfully, knowing that we are helping further his kingdom here on earth. Let's get to God in prayer. Dear God, we just want to pray for this gift and the giver, and that way we can further your kingdom and bring more souls to your kingdom, so one day we can all be in heaven with you. And we just want to pray this time that we can do this to glorify you. And we just want to pray in our son's name. Amen.
Good evening. Good to see everyone out this evening. We had a great time this morning with our Sunday school time and our morning sermon. Gospel and Dinosaurs, I believe, was the title. It was very good. Just a couple things to pass on. Come up and look at everything later, take pictures and whatnot, read this stuff. But please don't let your kids or anything pick anything up. You know, if it gets dropped or broke, Ryan said that I had to sell my kidneys, and I need them very bad. So please respect these things. They cost lots and lots of money. I was told one of the dinosaurs recently sold an auction, is this correct, for $3.2 million, one of the big ones? 30, okay, I was off. What? I don't think my kidneys will work. So $30.2 million, whoa. So you could just see what these things are what you will see in the museums, unless they actually have one of the bones. And Ryan was telling us this morning that some places have one, and they'll be saying, this is the bone that these other ones were created from. So these things are what you would find in the museums through all the major cities and everything, all around the land and everything. And they are important. They're very cool. Tonight is Dinosaur Night. We're excited. I know the young people were excited that are going to be here. And we're just so welcome to have Ryan Cox here with us, and also Bob Duga. He's up manning the table out there. He'll answer any of your questions about any of the books and DVDs and all that information that they have out there. A lot of good stuff out there. Please take a look at those things. And again, we want to thank their families and for being willing to come to Monroeville, Pennsylvania here and be able to share with us. I'm not going to ask all the different churches and that are here tonight, but we're so glad you're all here to share with us. And without further ado, I'm going to turn things over to Ryan and let him teach with us and explain some things about how great and almighty our Creator is. Come on up and preach the word, brother.
It's a dinosaur.
Look at this terrible look. Cold-bloodedness, it doesn't apply. They're totally wrong. This is a warm-bodied creature.
This thing doesn't live in a swamp.
This thing's got, what, a 25, 27-foot neck? Brachiosaur 30.
All right, who wants to go? Yeah, absolutely, I would. Why not? Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to share with you. I'm Ryan Cox with Creation Truth Foundation, as we shared this morning. And we are a Bible worldview training, gospel sharing ministry. What we try to do is help. Our mission statement is training disciples to trust the Bible's history for its accuracy, so they will trust its promises for their destiny. And that is what we do. We are trying to ground ourselves on a biblical worldview. There are only two worldviews out there, a biblical one or a non-biblical one, all right? And there's little varieties in there, but we are always in need of fine-tuning our worldview to make sure it's in alignment with this. And as I shared this morning, the whole reason this ministry was started is because of how we have seen for decades now entire generations being lost, walking away from the faith, though they were raised in the church, because there were questions that were not answered. There were these nice, wonderful little Bible stories with moral lessons at church, but then in school we got actual, real history and science. And it didn't necessarily, what they were teaching, match up with what we were being taught from the Bible. And one turns out being real and one a fairy tale, and we see people lost. Well, we want to provide the answers to that. We want to deal with a lot of these issues that have come up over the last two centuries, you could say. And the one, of course, that we really enjoy talking about is the issue of dinosaurs. Would anybody like to learn anything about dinosaurs tonight? You see, it's there, all ages, absolutely. Are you ready? Okay, so here we go. You ready to learn about dinosaurs? We're going to talk about that. Let's do a little Dinosaur 101, okay? And again, let me say, I don't want there to be any misconception. I am not a scientist. I am not a paleontologist. Okay, that's somebody who digs up the fossils. And I am a researcher. I have a degree in historical research and historical methods and all that kind of stuff. And I love history. And so I love the history of these guys. And I've been so blessed to get to know many great scientists and paleontologists and stuff like that, to get to study and learn from them. And then I just get to travel around and play with dinosaur bones. I mean, I'm going to have a good time tonight. I don't know about you. So here we go. Dinosaur 101, all right? First, you need to know, what is a dinosaur? What'd you say? It's a lizard, okay? A little more specific, it's a reptile. Okay, reptile, reptilian type. Now here's the difference. What is the difference? If you saw a lizard crawling around on the ground, would you call that a dinosaur? Okay, technically it does not meet the qualification for a dinosaur. See, here's what was happening. Back in the early 1800s, they're digging up these things and finding them. They're like, these are some really wild creatures. What are all these things? And they're noticing the anatomy is a little bit different. Little bit different from some of the things they had been seeing. So Richard Owen comes up with this idea of calling them Dinosauria. We're going to talk about that on Wednesday night, their whole name and all that kind of stuff. And he said, because there's a difference in their anatomy from other reptiles. When you see that lizard walk around, how does it walk? How does its legs look? That's exactly right. They're sprawled out like this. Okay, lizards walk like this. Okay, turtles, how are their legs? They're spread out like that, okay? Komodo dragon, okay? Your reptiles, most of your reptiles you see today, their legs are spread out like this. And the reason for that is they do not have a particular hole in their hip, okay? And they don't have the open acetabulum, is the fancy term for that, in their pelvis, okay? They don't have it. And so it's closed off, and they have the straight shaft femur there, okay? And they're like, dinosaurs are not like that. Every dinosaur has an open hole in the socket there. Okay, right over here, my Albertosaurus, my good friend, his name is Pebbles. Everybody say hi, Pebbles. Pebbles, okay, all right. This particular specimen, his name is Pebbles, and some of these have specific names because more than one of them have been dug up out of the ground, and so to keep them straight, they get official serial number designation, and then sometimes they get a field name. And this one's field name is Pebbles because of the pebbly matrix that it was found when it was discovered in Choteau, Montana. And so Pebbles here has the open hole here, and notice how the leg comes up, makes a right turn, and goes in there. Very similar to how you and I are designed. And so dinosaurs walk upright on their legs. How do dinosaurs walk? You are so good. You're going to sound so smart when you talk to your friends. This is great. So that's the difference in dinosaur anatomy. So they get their own classification when you're talking about reptiles in general. Dinosaurs get that separate classification because of how they walk upright on their legs. Okay, now here's the trick. Are you ready? This guy right here is a Tylosaurus. He's in the Mosasaur family. This particular specimen, his name is Bunker. Say hi, Bunker. Okay, this is Bunker. All right, because he was found by a guy named C.D. Bunker, and he is a 45-foot-long marine creature, lived in the water, has huge flippers, like 5-6-foot-long flippers. Big creature. Found in the middle of Kansas. A lot of oceanfront property in Kansas, isn't there? What had to be true about Kansas at some point in history? Had to been covered with water. Yes, okay, we're going to come to that. At some Tuesday night, we're going to talk about that. So, is he a dinosaur? What? I heard it. What's the answer? No, he is not. Because to be a dinosaur, what do you have to be able to do? Walk upright on your legs. He has flippers. So he is not a dinosaur. He is a reptile, though. He had nostrils, breathed oxygen, okay? He has the anatomy of a reptile. So his classification is marine reptile. Lived in the water, okay? How about this guy back up here? Okay, our pteranodon. He does not have a name because most pteranodons, you just find one piece here, one piece there, one piece there. And so he would technically be what's called a composite. They've taken all the different pieces and what we've learned over time and put it together. Okay, so that's not one particular one. That's one that's kind of a combination of them. And there's all kinds of them. They're really neat. He's a pteranodon. Pteranodons are bigger than pterodactyls, but they're all in that kind of family, Pterodactylae. And so pterodactyls usually about 3 to 5 foot wingspans. Pteranodons, 11 to 22, 24 foot wingspans. We've got one specimen we don't carry with us. It's called a pteranodon sternbergi. And he literally, his wingspan, he would take up the whole platform all by himself. So that's why he's not here. So is he a dinosaur? He is not. Because does he walk upright on his legs? No, in fact, what does he probably do with most of his time? Fly, spends his time in the air. In fact, he has this little particular bone right there. This little bone there, it's a taro bone. It's for flight. It acts as like a flap. You know how when the plane is going to land and you see on the front of the wings, it kind of turns down in order to kind of control the landing? Exact same thing is what that bone does. Okay, so that's how we're pretty sure they spent their time in the air. He is not a dinosaur, technically. His technical classification is flying reptile. Okay, that's it, all right? So, now, here's why you need to know this, because this is actually going to come into play in worldview by the time we finish this evening. I want to show you a little bit more about how these things are classified. When you're talking about the actual dinosaurs, they split them up into two major groups. And this goes all the way back to early 1800s when they were discovering some similarities and differences between dinosaurs, and they noticed one major characteristic about all dinosaurs, and that is their hip structure. They have one of two kinds of hips, and so they split them up into two groups of their hip structure. One is called saurischian. Saurus means lizard, reptile. And so that's called lizard-hipped. That would be like this guy, okay? His has that, the way his pelvis is shaped, the Albertosaurus there. The other kind is called bird-hipped, not because it looked like a bird, but because of the way the structure of the pelvis was and how it kind of similar to the way bird structure like. And so this Triceratops, field name is Gundy. Say hi, Gundy. You are just like the kids. This is great. So he has what's called the ornithischian, referring to bird hip type structure. So his hip is completely different, as you can see from that. And then all your dinosaurs are put into those two different categories of dinosaurs. Notice how he is upright on his legs, even when he has four of them. It's interesting, if you went to the American Museum of Natural History in New York, the one from not at the museum, their Triceratops there, because of when they originally discovered that long time ago, and we didn't quite have this all figured out, they have that Triceratops with his legs spread out like this. We now know much more over the last century about dinosaurs, and now he is positioned with his legs upright, as all dinosaurs are. Now, here's what I need you to know. Which dinosaurs are in these categories? Over here in the saurischian, in the lizard-hipped, we have the theropods. Theropods, two big legs, two itty bitty arms. Those are your theropods. So your raptors, your tyrannosaurs, all of those are in the which kind? What kind of hips do they have? Lizard hipped. I need you to remember that particular one. The theropods have what kind of hips? Lizard hips, okay? Also on that side are the sauropods. Sauropods, long neck, long tails. They got that same kind of hip structure. Their anatomy is phenomenal. It is amazing the design of how those bones are designed and how different kinds of bones they have to be able to hold the immense weight and size of those creatures. It's almost as if somebody sat down and designed that thing in perfect engineering. It's just phenomenal how that creature goes. But over on the other side of the lumbar hip, you have the thyrophore. That means those that have armor on them. So the stegosaurs, the ankylosaurs, nodosaurs, those kind over there. Ornithopods, Edmontosaurus. We have a skull here and a hind leg of one. We'll talk about him in a little bit. And one of the other nights, Paraceralophus, all those kinds, Iguanodon, those kinds. The Pachycephalosauria kind, we got one right here, we'll talk about her in a little bit. And the Ceratopsians, okay, all of those are on that side. But the one I need you to remember is the theropods have what kind of hips? Lizard hip, all right, so we're moving on now, okay? They do, in every one of those categories, have really, really big specimens. They also have little bitty specimens. As we talked about this morning, all we're used to is how they're portrayed in the movies. And we see all the big gargantuans. But they're also itty-bitty dinosaurs, okay? Like a Compsognathus, it's like that big. That's all the taller he is. Or a Cynosauropteryx, okay? Or Cerebellus, these itty-bitty little dinosaurs. When you average them all together, the adult size of all, from the biggest to smallest, would be about the size of a bison, an American buffalo. Okay, and not the size of this guy. This guy, found in the fossil record, this is a bison latifrons. It's identical to a bison today, except for his size. If this is his skull, which is pretty big, but if he were standing in here, his back, you know, the hump on the back of a buffalo, of a bison, okay, would be at a basketball rim, 10 foot tall. That's a pretty big guy. This is pretty good. Okay, that's just a cool fun fact. That has nothing to do with what we're talking about tonight. So anyway, dinosaurs. As I said, when we go places and we go to church camps and we go to VBSs and we talk with young people, the vast amount of their understanding, and the same with adults now, because we're going into three decades of this now, is based upon what we have learned in movies. And so we really need to delve into this understanding of dinosaurs in movies, because when it's all said and done at the end of the day, we're talking about the influence in our lives of our worldviews and how we understand dinosaurs, and it comes greatly from portrayals in media. Not necessarily even textbooks, although the textbooks and the museums often reflect what's shown in the movies and not the actual science regarding these creatures, okay? So we need to deal with this. We need to talk about the dinosaurs in movies. So let's start with one of my favorites, my all-time favorites, the biggest, the scariest, the most intimidating of all dinosaurs ever of all time. Hold it, prepare the kids, brace yourselves. The scariest dinosaur of all time. Look out. Scariest dinosaur of all time. There you go. Okay. So, how scientifically accurate are the portrayals of the dinosaurs? Let's start with my favorite, the Tyrannosaurus Rex. And listen to the description of T-Rex given in this scene from the great movie of Jurassic Park.
Well, we clocked the T-Rex to 32 miles an hour.
How fast? 32.
T-Rex?
Mm-hmm.
You said you've got a T-Rex?
Uh-huh. Say again. We have a T-Rex.
Wow. Put your head between your knees.
Dr. Grant, my dear Dr. Sattler, welcome to Jurassic Park.
Thank you. I could have cut the clip shorter, but I really like the music. So, you know, any chance I get to play music. Well, here's how it works in the movies, okay? You have the biggest and baddest of them all of all time, the Tyrannosaurus Rex. And he is voracious. He is relentless. He will sniff you out from miles away. He will track you down. He will hunt you down. He will not give up until he has caught you because he's the most intimidating predator of all time. And the only way you can possibly ever escape this incredible creature is if you happen to have a Jeep Wrangler. That's the story we're told of T-Rex, and that he can chase you down at what kind of speed? Is there any science to back that up? Well, here's what went on with Mr. T-Rex. First, T-Rex fossils are discovered and found, and they start piecing together what this creature is. And finally then, Mr. Henry Fairfield Osborne in 1905 gives him this name, the Great Tyrant Lizard King, because he seems to be the scariest and the baddest of all. I mean, this guy is huge. He is humongous, intimidating. And then in 1989, we found his arms, and then it was like, oh, well, those are cute. Kind of embarrassing for the guy. He couldn't even scratch his own nose, you know, but it's okay. Well, let me tell you about our T-Rex here. This T-Rex is really, really cool. This T-Rex is called Stan. Everybody say hi, Stan. Okay, Stan was discovered in 1989. They began digging up in 91. Stan Sackerson was a guy who happened to just stumble upon him, saw his pelvis sticking out of the side of a cliff, and then called the Larson brothers of the Black Hill Institute in South Dakota. They were professional diggers, findings. They're also the ones who dug up Sue, who's on display in the Chicago Few Museum. And they began to excavate Stan. It took 30,000 hours to excavate him and get him cleaned up and put up on display, and that is his actual fossil there. Now, here's the cool thing. As we talked about this morning when I answered the question, are those real, okay, as we said, if this was the actual one, there's no way we could pick him up without a forklift because he would be solid rock. It's just incredible and very brittle, very, very, you know, you got to be very delicate with him. But the amazing thing about this one was, when they found Sue the dinosaur, and she's the biggest T-Rex of all time to date, she's about 40 to 43 feet long and 14 feet tall at the hips. You measure dinosaurs at the hips. You see why with pebbles over there, okay? Because of how they walked, you measure them at their hips. Sue is 14 feet at the hips. Stan is 13 feet at the hips, 12 to 13 feet at the hips, and about 40 feet long. So, I mean, he's just barely. At the time when he was found, he was the biggest. But Sue surpassed him on that. But when they found Sue, her head was crushed and underneath her pelvis. Something disastrous happened that killed her and buried her. Stan also was killed and buried in a cataclysmic event. But the thing about his skull was it was perfectly disarticulated, taken apart into all of its pieces, and preserved without being crushed. It was the most intact skull ever discovered of any T-Rex to this date. It's the most incredible skull ever found. Guess what every laboratory, university, museum wanted to get their hands on? Stan. They all wanted a Stan because they wanted to study it. This is the greatest opportunity to learn about T-Rexes ever in history, so everybody wanted Stan. So the Larson brothers there at Black Hills Institute, they began to make research-level replicas. Every one of these you see, and most of them that you will see at natural history museums are exactly that. They're research-level replicas cast directly from them. So from a scientific perspective, you are looking at the actual fossil. It's just not the one that was dug out of the ground. You can put this particular one. This is one of them. There are about 60 in the world, and this is one of them. This T-Rex is. This is a Stan right here. It's really, really neat. This is the most observed, ever seen T-Rex. And if you went to their museum back before October of this last year, all of that is Stan except for the head. That head up on that one is the replica one. The real one is down around the corner. And you can see it, okay? But so it's just like this one that's up there. But you can't tell any difference. You put this through a CAT scan, you'll get the exact same result as the real one. And so we learned so much from Stan. October of last year, October 6th, He was sold at auction for $31.8 million to an anonymous buyer. We now have no idea where Stan is. And the paleontological world is freaking out because we have no idea where he went. He could be in some wealthy person's living room in their parlor when you walk in. There's Stan, I have him. And scientists may never see him again for a generation, who knows? So there are a lot of people upset about that, but we still have this one and the other ones that have been made, and so we get to study him and learn a lot about T-Rexes since the discovery of Stan. One of the big things we love about T-Rexes is their what? Their teeth. Okay, here's a T-Rex tooth. This is a replica one, so I can pass that one around, but I better get it back. It's the only one I got, okay? And so you'll notice the little serrations on the sides there, okay? Very impressive teeth. You can pass that around. And exactly, pick your teeth. Okay, and the thing about these teeth, they're big and sharp. And we know for a fact that big, sharp teeth always, always means voracious meat eater, right? 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 No? What's a panda bear use its sharp teeth for?
Bamboo.
Exactly. Is it 100% certain that if a creature has sharp teeth, it automatically means meat eater? No. Is it a pretty good guess? Yes, but it might not always be accurate. There, you can do other study to find out if it did or not. Here's how this plays into worldview. When God made everything during that first week of creation, he always said, at the end of the day, it is good, which means it was perfect, complete, zero death. In fact, the very last thing he says at the end of day six is, I've given all the green plants, all the vegetation, all the fruit for you to eat, for all the animals and for humanity. Why? Because there was no death. Why was there no death? There had been no sin yet. It was perfect, as only God would make it. Now, wait a minute. Dinosaurs are animals. From a biblical worldview, they would have been made on day number six because they walk on land upright on their legs. Who else was made on day six? People. Okay, so the biblical worldview is that people would have lived at the same time as dinosaurs. Oh, if you want to know more about that, come Wednesday night. That's all Wednesday night's about. Oh, it's going to be so much fun. And would a T-Rex in the Garden of Eden been allowed to eat other animals? No. He would have eaten vegetation. That's what he had been required to eat. He couldn't have survived on that. Can animals we think of as carnivorous survive on a vegetable fruit diet? Yes, they can. One of the neat things they do at our zoo in Oklahoma City is for their birthdays, they give tigers watermelon. And they love it. They first kind of play around with it like a mouse. They just kind of swat around, spin it around, that kind of thing. And then they start biting into it, and they eat the whole thing. They devour it. They love it. It's so good. Fresh watermelon in summer? Are you kidding? Even a tiger would eat it. Here's another neat little story, though. Back in 1946, at the New York City Zoo, there was a little lion cub that was born. And the workers at the zoo were ready to run in and rescue her because the mother had been killing its young. And so they go and they rescue this one. They call it Little Tyke. It's a little female lion cub. And so they began to raise it and everything. And it ended up being in the custody of Georges and Margaret Westbow of upper state New York, I believe. They had a place where they took care of animals. And I'm not making this up. The name of their area where they did it was called Hidden Valley Ranch. It really was. Okay. And so they were up. But the thing was, as they were trying to wean Little Tyke, they could not get her to eat any meat. Would not eat any meat. They would try to puree it, stick it in food and everything. She'd spit it out. She would not eat it. The taste of it. Well, they began to become pretty concerned about this. They eventually offered in the 1950s, early 1950s, late 40s, early 50s, a $1,000 reward. That's big money. If somebody could come up with a way to help them with it. there was a little field trip coming through, looking at all their animals and everything, and they were telling the story of Little Tyke, and there was this boy who raises his hand. He's like, yeah? He's like, I know why she won't eat meat. They're like, why? He said, well, the Bible says that when God made all the animals, they ate only plants, so she can be just fine eating plants. Like, what? They go back, Genesis chapter 1, verse 30, they look at the promise God made, eat plants. They never worried about it after that. And all the veterinarians who ever came and observed Little Tyke said she was one of the healthiest, had one of the most beautiful coats of any lions they'd ever seen. So could it survive? Could T-Rex survive on a vegetarian diet? Yes, he could, okay? It can be. What's a dog do when it gets sick? Eats grass, okay? All right, it can be done. Now, am I saying that's all they ever did eat then from there on? No, I'm not saying that. Although I would think it'd be pretty cool. You know those county fair winning pumpkins? You know, I mean, he could use those teeth to eat those kinds of things. But there have been some neat things that have been discovered. Over time, after the fall, when sin entered the world and death and pain and suffering and carnivory, T-Rex did eat some meat. So I mentioned our Edmontosaurus over here, this Hadrosaur, this duck-billed guy right here, okay? Back in, let me see, on my note here, 2013, they found a backbone of one of those, one of the vertebrae, and inside of it was a T-Rex tooth. Where's my T-Rex tooth? There it is, okay? They found a T-Rex tooth broken off in that backbone, but here's the thing. Not only had it been broken off in there, it had been healed over. So that Hadrosaur got away that day, and T-Rex had lost a tooth. In fact, that's one of the interesting things about T-Rex is trying to figure out exactly his diet, because you see that tooth, that's a full-grown size tooth. About 7-8 inches they get. The biggest one ever is around 11-12 inches. But as the bigger they get here, the less anchored they are in the dentiary, up here in his jaw. They become very easy to break off and him to lose them. But here's the cool thing. Like any good reptile, like an alligator or a crocodile, he's got more ready to grow right in. When you come up here and look at him very closely, there's one right here, there's one right here. You can see the little baby one starting to grow in already, ready to take its place. And that's why he's got these little ones here and bigger size, because he loses them. So one of the ideas is maybe he had to do some scavenging to help supplement his diet. Because if he goes and he just bites into one of these things and it shakes all around, he could lose half his teeth. And that wouldn't be good. So maybe he wasn't the voracious predator he may have been. But they did find that backbone, and it was one. It must have been alive when he bit into it. So, you know, maybe it's a combination. Maybe it was one way or the other. All it means is we need to keep studying and keep learning. What you see in the movies is exactly that, a movie. Jurassic Park was not a documentary. You all understand that. Okay, so it's a movie. Here's some other neat things about it. To hold up this head, the way his neck is designed, the first set of vertebrae kind of fused to give him strength on that. One of the studies showed that he could take a 100-pound person, toss him 15 feet in the air. That's how strong he was. Pretty cool. And then the teeth, his bite force. Some of these spots here, these little windows here, these holes, are called fenestra, and that's where the muscle attachments were for the jaw. They put that stuff into computer models to see maybe what his bite force would be. Stan is one of them that they've used for that. Bite force is anywhere from 7,800 to 12,800 pounds of bite force. Here's the cool thing about that. In the third movie, Jurassic Park, they have this dinosaur that's bigger than T-Rex. Anybody remember what it was? Spinosaurus is correct. Spinosaurus, 50 foot long. Big creature. They have it come up to T-Rex and tangle with the T-Rex. And guess who in the movie wins? The Spinosaurus. So I have these kids that come in again. Spinosaurus could have taken T-Rex. Spinosaurus is bigger, better T-Rex. I say, here's the problem with that. T-Rex's bite force, 12,800, that is the strongest of any land creature ever. way more than Spinosaurus, more than Gorgosaurus, more than any of them that have been found to be bigger than T-Rex. His bite force is stronger, according to the latest studies, than any. So strong that if he got a bite on Spinosaurus, he would have crushed his bone and sucked the bone marrow right out. That's my favorite T-Rex. Could he have chased him down at 32 miles per hour? The science says not even close, which is another reason about wondering whether he was this voracious predator or not. At the time that movie comes out, 1993, the latest study had said 31 miles per hour. So in Jurassic Park, theirs had to go how fast? 32. They had to be faster, you know, because they had to have the biggest of all of them all there. But since then, greater understanding from the fossil record, from the anatomy, the computer models, they put this in there. The latest studies say anywhere from 11 to 17 miles per hour tops. So most likely he could kind of walk with a big gait and maybe take a spurt. That's about it. That's 17 miles an hour, pretty fast, you know. So here's the deal. If you ever run into a T-Rex with your friends, you tell them, run in a zigzag. Well, you run straight and you'll be okay. Okay, so just a little tip if you run into a T-Rex. So, all right, so there you go. That's T-Rex. Here's the thing, though. So influential are these movies and the worldview about T-Rex currently, right now, in the St. Louis Science Center. Science Center is this sign about T-Rex that says at least 20 feet tall and weighing, wait, 20 feet. Sue's the biggest. How tall did I tell you she was? 14. I have no idea. I have no idea where they got that number. 20 feet tall, 15 tons, Tyrannosaurus Rex was the largest flesh-eating animal ever to walk the land. The dinosaur possessed massive jaws armed with 7-inch knife-like teeth. Its bite could leave a 3-foot-wide hole in its prey. Tyrannosaurus was a swift, and he's so light on his feet at 15 tons. Swift and savage hunter, capable of speeds up to 40 miles per hour faster than a modern thoroughbred horse. They haven't had any number close to that in 3 decades. Yet the kids get all excited about it and believe what they see in the movies, which is opening up the door for other teachings that are erroneous. Here's another little quick fun one, just so you know about dinosaurs and why you don't just take what you see on TV as legitimate. You need to study, such as in this one.
Okay.
Hey, you, look at me. Hey.
Come with me.
Okay.
These guys are known for doing what? Headbutting. Yes, absolutely. Because you've seen them do that, haven't you? Where? In the movies. Exactly. This particular specimen, this is a Pachycephalosaurus wyomingus. You never guess where they found her. And her name is Sandy. Say hi, Sandy. That's Sandy. It's named after not a person, but the Sandy sediment that they found her in, okay? So Sandy here, dome-headed, okay? Pachycephalosaurus, they're known for their dome head, solid bone, this whole area up here. Interesting thing, though, when they found this particular one, they found her intact with her neck bones, with her vertebrae. Very cool. That's our actual, we actually have a full one of these. The thing, though, was it wasn't what they were expecting, considering we've always thought and always seen her running her head into things. Because if you look there in the picture, you'll notice how her neck attaches to her head. Where's her neck coming into the head? See that? It's not at the top. That's exactly right. If you've ever seen a goat or a ram, when they put their head down, their neck is perfectly aligned with their back. So they got that strength to run their head into something. Not so with the Pachy. It's coming right up in the middle there. And the way the vertebrae were designed and arranged and the size of them, they're like, mm-mm. If she were to do that, the way her neck is and the way it comes in there, and because this is domed, if her head glances off of something, she's going to snap her neck. She can't be a headbutter. Well, then the question is, well, what does she do? Notice these little spikes, these nodes up here? They have found skulls of other ones where they have puncture holes up here, and they match the size of the spikes. So the idea now is that they use the spikes for attack and the dome for defense. And it was for protection. It's an amazing design from the Creator God. So that's there you go. There's another little fun fact you can talk about. Hey, there you go. She won't headbutt you. I promise, she won't do it. She won't headbutt you. Hey. Another little fun fact. The creature that has been measured possibility as the creature with the strongest bite force ever, 24,000 pounds. The megalodon, 60-foot shark. So there you go. Hey, you guys want to pass this one around? You want to see the pet megalodon? Yeah, come here. Come on, you can get it. There you go. Here you go. You can come take a look at this one and then pass that one around so everybody else can see that one, okay? Megalodon tooth. Look at that. That's like the size of your face, isn't it? Isn't that cool? 24,000 pounds. They had to stop the measurement because if it got any stronger, it would crush his own jaw. It's just amazing what that creature may have been able to do. Okay, last one from the movies. One of the most popular of all time from the movies. The Raptors. Oh, they're like the scariest of them all. You know, I mean, these guys are scary. They got big teeth. In fact, this is something new. This is their first time. It's really exciting. There's a Christian couple that actually packages fossils and puts on here how they were created by God, how the fossils were formed 4,500 years ago in the flood. And so these are actual real mosasaur teeth. Just like this guy with the fossils, but we got back there. So we're so happy to got to meet them and know them and be able to bring actual fossils that young people and adults can get. And it has the actual biblical worldview on them. It's really neat. So it's called Everything Fossil. But anyway, so these raptors, oh, they're nasty. And they are the most intelligent, skillful set of dinosaurs we've ever known about. And we see them do the most amazing feats in the movies, including what you just saw there. He does two things in that scene. We didn't play all of it. But first he comes up to the window, and what does he do to the window? Fogs it up, steams it up. And then uses his little arms and opens the door to come inside. Now here's the deal about that. What kind of creatures are dinosaurs? Reptiles. What's true about their body temperatures? Cold-blooded, ectothermic. What does he do to the window? Fogs it up. Can cold-bodied creatures do that? No, they can't. Because they don't have the internal metabolism, body temperature, that is heating up the breath and the moisture in there to do that, to steam them up. Yet they do that in the movie. One, because it's really cool. But second of all, it's because of the worldview regarding these particular dinosaurs. They, in the movies of Jurassic Park, you pay very close attention. In the very first clip I showed you, he walks up to that big Brachiosaurus and says, This is a warm-bodied creature. Did you catch that? And then what do they have the dinosaur do? Steam up the window. In all the Jurassic Park movies, all their dinosaurs are, guess what? Warm-blooded, endothermic. Why? Because the paleontologist involved with these creatures has a worldview about dinosaurs that's not biblical. Let me show you. Jack Horner, paleontologist, brilliant paleontologist, one of the greatest in the world, Montana State University, is the guy who helped with the dinosaurs on Jurassic Park. Listen to what he says about dinosaurs and how then they portray them in the movies.
To help portray scientifically accurate behavior,
filmmakers
enlisted the help of paleontologist Jack Horner, one of the world's leading dinosaur experts.
He is really good.
Horner's research has been instrumental in changing our view of dinosaurs. He contends that birds, not reptiles, represent their closest living link.
Oh.
For Jurassic's design team, maintaining scientific accuracy would mean breaking the reptilian stereotypes associated with dinosaurs.
The whole idea is to get people to look at dinosaurs more like birds than as reptiles.
What's his worldview? That these guys evolved into birds. Wait a minute, what are birds? Cold-blooded or warm-blooded? Warm-blooded. Guess what the dinosaurs then have to be for his worldview? Warm-blooded, even though they're reptiles. Oh, I'm sorry, that's a reptilian stereotype, as they said there. And so that's not politically correct to call them reptiles anymore. And that wasn't just the first set of movies. Guess who they got to come back to do the new set of movies, the Jurassic World movies?
And Jack Horner, he is our resident paleontologist.
It's pretty cool being one of the very few people that's been on all four of the Jurassic Park films.
He brings the credibility that we need to the story and really makes sure that it's scientifically correct.
Scientifically accurate. Now listen to the direction here.
Like raptor helmets, they have to be able to get into the mindset of how a raptor moves and, you know, the sort of the predatory qualities that give the actors like visual cues to make them even scarier.
Okay, here it comes.
They're going to be like working together. So it'd be like wolves or trained dogs that are all moving up to a point and looking around trying to find their prey. Anything that's a little bit more bird-like is helpful. So instead of doing a head turn like that, if it's a...
There's one direction, just don't look silly.
I had a lady come up to me one time. She said, you know, every time I see my chicken run across the yard, it kind of reminds me of a dinosaur running across the yard. I said, really? When was the last time you saw the dinosaur run across the yard? When is the last time she saw a dinosaur run? In the movie. And how did they make the dinosaur behave? Like a chicken, like a bird. We're being evolutionized before our very eyes, and we don't even realize it. We, as warm-bodied creatures, have these little things in our noses right here called nasal turbinates. The reason we have those is because when we breathe out, we're heating up things inside of us. They catch the moisture when we're breathing out so that we don't dehydrate ourselves. Isn't it amazing how God just happened to think of everything? If they're warm-bodied, guess what they should have? Nasal turbinates. I come over here to Stan, the most intact skull we've ever discovered. I pick his nose, take a look here. Guess what's not in there? Nasal turbinates. They're not in there. But what do they keep saying over and over and over? To be scientifically accurate. See why we got to study this stuff. So the next thing about these creatures, I hate to sometimes do this, but the raptors in Jurassic Park, what's their actual name? What are they called? Velociraptors, that's right. Velociraptors, massive, nasty, crazy creatures. Yes, they're about this tall. They're no taller than your knee. Right there. What they're showing you is it's designed to look like a Deinonychus, and it's the size of a Utah raptor, okay? All right, so here's one of those types, right? If it was one of the big ones, it'd be like this. This is a raptor. This is his big toe. Okay, he can't slash with it. What these things are designed to do is puncture in there. They jump and they puncture in, and then it's anchored in, and you cannot get that thing out of you. Okay, so here you go. Raptor claw, passing that around, from a Utah Raptor. We're like, well, why didn't they call it a Utah Raptor? Well, they're like, hey, the Utah Raptors are coming. Oh, let's turn on to watch the basketball game. You know, it just didn't sound right. Whereas Velociraptor, much scarier. Okay, but so that's why. You know, this is my son. He was like six, seven years old looking at a Velociraptor skull. Okay, they're not the big, it's the different kinds. There's a Dakota Raptor, it's about that big as well. So again, it's a movie. But they are trying to tell a story. Remember, when he gets to that door and steams it up, what's he do to the door? He opens it. You're being evolutionized. One of the rules in paleontology for theropods, these guys here, for the raptors, okay, is that they are clappers, not slappers. They cannot pronate their hands. They cannot supinate them. They are stuck like this. Let me show you. This is incredible anatomy. I had my uncle, who's in physical therapy, read some of the scientific papers on this. And he then explained this to me. Oh, this is so cool, okay? The humerus here, big arm. Then you have the ulna and the radius. Is there any medical people in here? Okay, am I saying this right? Make sure I get this right, okay? I'm not a scientist. I want to get this right, okay? So here's what's so neat about this. The ulna here is anchored right in the middle of this arm bone. Because of this, okay, right here in the middle, okay? Because of that and the way it's connected, he cannot move this bone over so that he can pronate and supinate. He can't do that. But here's what's really cool about it. You're like, those itty-bitty arms, are those good for anything? Oh my, yes. First of all, the amazing design. That tail balances him. If his arms are any bigger, he'd be overweight on the front and he'd fall right over on his face. Brilliant in the design of this creature. But these arms, because of the way that works, how far back, if you stuck your hand straight out, everybody stick your hand straight out, okay? How far over can you move your fingers back? Now keep your hand straight, don't bend your wrist, just how far, keep your hand, wrist straight, how far can you move your fingers back? That's about it, okay? This guy, his can come back like this. His two claws come back like this. And what happens is, when he extends his arm, it pushes the claws out because of how the bones are anchored on here. We're not even talking muscle. So he sticks his arm out, his claws come out like this. Guess what happens when he retracts his arm? It pulls it in and it is locked. You cannot escape that. And we're not even talking muscle, just the mechanics here of this arm. So here's what we think they would do. They would puncture in with that toe, that anchor, onto whatever the creature is, and then these parts here, these are sharp. They are for slicing and dicing, and this thing goes to work on a cow or an Edmontosaurus or something like a hibachi grill. He just like that. I mean, and he is going to slay that creature right then and there. You talk about nasty creature. This thing is incredible when you look at the actual science. But in the movies and in the toys, they portray their hands how? Like this. Can they do that? No, they cannot do that, okay? That is not possible. And there's a reason for why they do that. And it's because of this worldview they're trying to push on us. You go to the Chicago Field Museum. I took these pictures when Bob and I got to go there a couple years ago on our way back from a meeting in Michigan. You come up to this sign. It says, what is a dinosaur? It says, dinosaurs are reptiles. All right, we're doing good. I agree, we're doing good. You go around the corner. You come to a sign that says, birds are dinosaurs. You know, have you ever heard the saying, well, you know, those Christians, you know, if you're going to be a Christian, you have to check your brain at the door to believe what they teach? You ever heard something like that? This is what's being taught in the halls of academia today. You go to the all-knowing Wikipedia and look up reptile, Crocodiles are more closely related to birds than they are to lizards. For this reason, many modern scientists consider birds now are classified today, now, are part of reptilia. Birds are classified in reptilia now. You look up birds, the fossil record indicates that birds evolved from earlier feathered dinosaurs, we're going to talk about that in just a second, within the, which group? The theropod group. The theropods are the ones that evolved into birds. Of all the dinosaurs you could pick, what are the two kinds of hips they have? Lizard hip and bird hip. And the ones they pick to turn into birds are which ones? The lizard hip ones. Saurischian dinosaurs. Their closest living relatives are, for birds, are crocodiles. So when you see a crocodile, you're supposed to think, nah, that's not related to like a Komodo dragon or anything. But a penguin, yeah. This is one of their diagrams. Crocodile, Saurischian, birds. Their process of evolution. And look at who's this is in Scientific American. Jack Horner. National Geographic 2004, he said this. For 20 years, we've done what we call arm waving. We've made hypotheses based on very little evidence. Now we're sitting down, we're saying, we've got all these ideas. Are they real? Wait a minute. Did they have the evidence and then come up with their idea? Or did they come up with the idea and now try to find evidence for it? How scientific is that? And now that we know the science? But you go to, and by the way, this is not universal. They make it seem like in all the literature today, you read any literature today, National Geographic, Scientific American, whatever, it is universal. All scientists, all paleontologists believe that dinosaurs evolved into birds. That is so false. These are evolutionists, non-Bible believers, who absolutely think that is hooey. Scientific term there, hooey, okay? They said the anatomy is so, you realize what you'd have to do to turn a bird. Bob is a bird aficionado. He loves birds. He studied birds. This is the thing that upsets him most. I mean, look out. When you say a dinosaur evolved in bird, he'll punch you. I mean, just don't say it around, okay? You know how Bob is. Anyway, I mean, he is like, there's no way. The anatomical differences between those, but if you go to the Oklahoma Museum of Natural History, you'll see this picture here. Putting a chicken beside this guy right here, Dromaeosaurus. He's a raptor. All raptors are in the Dromaeosaur family. This is particularly a Dromaeosaurus. Look how they have his arms. And look at how they have him standing. Like he's getting ready to do what? Yeah. And look at the bird. Birds don't walk like that. They don't stand like that. When you see them standing, their legs are like this. They're all their weights on their knees, not in the hips, like a dinosaur. Like I said, this is our guy here. This is how they actually stand, how they're articulated. All right? And you see the arms? And yet they talk about how the wrist bones are like this. So that, here's why they all look like this. So that they can do what? Flap. Tuck in their wings, and then can they actually do that with their arms? No, they cannot. Yet even in the museums of science, they do this to them. So you'll believe the story, the worldview. This is not about science. Never has been. It's about worldviews. It's about faith. Both sides. They put feathers on them. This was done by National Geographic, PBS. This was their portrayal of how dinosaurs evolved into birds. And it's very interesting. This is from 2003 they put this together. And Dr. Charles Jackson used to be with our ministry. He moved back closer to family in Virginia. He looked at this and he went and put on there the ages that evolutionists say they are, the supposed evolutionary ages of every one of these things up there. And then I went and did it after I saw him do it just to double check other sources and match them up. And this is what was interesting. This is the order they put them in evolution, one evolving into the other. But when you actually look them up individually, these are the ages they say how old those fossils are of when those things lived. You put it on there together, you have the 122-million-year-old evolving to the 74-million-year-old, evolving into the 94, into the 125, into the 122, into the 147 and 125, the two oldest on there, and then present day. This is National Geographic. Were they hoping nobody would notice? This is the science versus religion debate. So they try to put feathers on these things. This was one of the National Geographic depictions of a T-Rex with feathers. It looks like a rat to me. I'm like, what in the world? Here's a couple others. This one used to be on Wikipedia. They finally took it off. Guess what the science says? They have feathers? No. This is our best look yet at Tyrannosaurus rex. This was a National Geographic article from 2017. Based on the texture of the bone, the researchers say its face would have been covered in what? Scales like those on modern what? Crocodiles, just like reptiles. And how much? Body-wide, crocodilian skin. So here's what they've done now. The only places where they have not found skin, scaly skin, that's where they stick feathers on. Right here on the little back of the, on the back and right at the top of the head, and of course at the end of the tail, because, oh yeah, you can just add them onto the end of the tail. Have we ever found these feathers on them? Nope. In fact, instead, we found these scales on them. And you should look at the headlines when they talk about this stuff. World's only fossils of T-Rex skin suggests it was covered in scales, not feathers. Like, why do you even have to add that on there? It's because that's what they're teaching. Here's another one. Tyrannosaurus rex had scaly skin and wasn't covered in feathers, new study says. T-Rex was likely covered in scales, not feathers. Look at the disappointment. This is the actual scientific paper that was published in Royal Society. And you think they're going to give up, though? No. Look at this. This is National Geographic as well. Pattern among the Tyrannosaur kin, they all, how many? All had skin texture with small pebbly scales and not fuzzy plumage. Multiple patches they found, multiple, pretty clear. The majority of them not covered in feathers. And then here's the science. But maybe that's the exception. Wait a minute. How many had scaly skin? All that they've ever found, ever actually observed. But maybe that's the exception. Maybe there's plenty of evidence that early tyrannosaurs had feathers. Where? Down in my heart. I'm. Because remember, is it a matter of this? It's a matter of this. Every time. That's what we're dealing with here. The evolution of feathers was more complex than maybe we previously thought. We can't say for sure why one tyrannosaur would be feathered and another not so much. Estimates suggest both animals would have endured similar average size. So there's this one called the Eutyrannus that they have fossils of. This is from 2017. In China. And he's got these little, around his fossil, they've got these little strewn patterns coming out. These little filaments, these fibers that are coming up. And he said, there it is. Those are feathers right there. Those are our feathers. We found them. That's it. Okay. Well, we've actually found feathers in the fossil record, which that in itself is amazing, at how quick those things had to be buried and preserved with lots of mud, lots of water, very quickly, for those of you who are in Sunday school. That's an amazing thing right there. But here's the actual best thing they have to date. From 2016, they found a piece of amber with a little tail in it, 3.6 centimeters big, and it had little feathers on it, and said, "That's a dinosaur tail with feathers." 3.6 centimeters. That's it. That's all there is on this. And when you actually look at the peer review paper that was published on this later, here's what it said. The feathers are comparable to the contours of many modern birds. Did they find feathers on a dinosaur? No. One of the ones they like to use is Cynoceratopsis. It's a little dinosaur. And they see these little fibers coming off and they say, "Those are feathers. Those are feathers." And part of the reason is because we've actually found birds. This right here is an Archaeopteryx. It's a bird. It's not a dinosaur. It's a bird. And you can kind of see these little patterns coming off it for the wings. Okay? Well, anytime they see any kind of pattern like that, it's automatically feathers. Those are wings. So here it is on this one here. One of those guys I showed you earlier who doesn't buy into this is a guy named Dr. Alan Fiducia. He's an expert on this stuff. And he said, "You know what? I found the same thing on another fossil. Here it all is. Look at all these patterns here. Integumentary fibers is what it's called. Integumentary fibers. All these things that are strewn off of them. You know what? I bet they've got to be feathers. They got to be feathers. You know, they've got to be feathers because that's what you said they are. Integumentary fibers of an ichthyosaurus." This guy, this lady right back here, this plate here, ichthyosaurus. Guess where ichthyosaurs lived? In the water. They're marine reptiles. Exact same stuff that they're calling feathers on other creatures. Guess what they've done? Several other guys now have done lab experiments where they've put muscle material in water, and as it's decaying away, it makes these little strewn out patterns that then if it gets buried in sediment and then becomes a fossil, makes those patterns. Have we ever found feathers on a dinosaur? No. Yet, everywhere you go now, it is the accepted understanding that these theropods were covered in feathers.
We have discovered that dinosaur DNA, and all DNA, just breaks down too fast. We're just not going to be able to do what they did in Jurassic Park. We're not going to be able to make a dinosaur based on a dinosaur. But birds are dinosaurs.
Do we have any evidence?
Birds are living dinosaurs.
Any feathers? No.
We actually classify them as dinosaurs. We now call them non-avian dinosaurs and avian dinosaurs. So the non-avian dinosaurs are the big clunky ones that went extinct. Avian dinosaurs are our modern birds. So we don't have to make a dinosaur. So I already have them.
This is a guy named Jack Horner. Have you heard of him?
I know. You're as bad as the sixth graders, right? The sixth graders look at it and they say, "No. You can call it a dinosaur, but look at the velociraptor. The velociraptor is cool. The chicken is not." So this is our problem, as you can imagine.
Listen now,
the chicken is a dinosaur. I mean, it really is. I mean, you can't argue with it because we're the classifiers and we've classified it that way.
With any evidence, purely their worldview. So bad is it now. Years ago, you ever see toys like this in places? Okay, dinosaur toys. This was a raptor one that I saw several years ago now. And it's really good. It's pretty good. His arms are pretty much correct. And he's all scaly skin, except right here on the arm, what did they put? Color matching feathers, so you wouldn't notice them at first, but that you would get used to the idea of seeing them with feathers on her. There'd be these little feathers on her, okay? Then, this was the next one they released. His arms are correct. He has the correct arms, okay, but covered in feathers, painted nice and bright and pretty. Same, supposed to be the same dinosaur, okay, one of these raptors. Are they holding anything back at this point? No. Then about 2 years ago or 3 years ago, hold on. I got too many toys. Here it is. Supposed to be the same one. Same creature. They've gone back to having him drag his tail on the ground before we ever even understood how dinosaurs walk. And what are they doing with the hands? Doing this, covered in feathers. And then last year, remember that first one I showed you? Remember him? They re-released him. Fully feathered and fully colored. We're being evolutionized before our very eyes, even in the toys that we play with, the cartoons we watch, the movies we portray. And I'm not saying don't watch any of the movies or anything. I'm telling you, you need to be aware of what is going on. The inundation we have, the relentlessness of trying to change worldviews, ultimately, so that you don't believe in God's word, but instead, you believe in these feather tails. Is there anything in science at all that disproves this book? Not a one. Instead, what are you starting to see about science? It confirms, when you do actual, observable, testable, falsifiable science, real science, what does it support every time? Did we expect anything less? This book is amazing. There's not a thing recorded in it that isn't true, including when it tells us that God so loved us, He gave His only Son for us. And those who would come to Him and be covered by the blood of the Lamb, as we talked about this morning, can have everlasting life. Father, we thank You for that promise. We thank You that Your word stands true. No matter the attacks that are fired at it, every moment of every day, it stands true. May we take our stand upon Your word. May it be a firm foundation upon which we are never shaken. Challenge us. May we study. May we ask questions. And may we seek answers, knowing in so doing we are seeking You and Your wisdom and seeing the riches You have to unfold before us, that we would greater appreciate and believe and love the One who made us. Thank You. You've taken such effort to give us this book. May we know Your heart and mind for us, and may we share it with a world that is desperate for truth, that is desperate for hope. May they see the love and joy of Jesus in us as we share the gospel, Jesus Christ, with them. That is our prayer and our conviction that we ask for Your help and assistance as we give You all praise and glory through the name of our Creator and Savior, Jesus. And those who would take their stand upon the word said.
Amen. Our men can come up and get ready for our invitation. Again, Ryan, thank you for the presentation. hopefully the young people were able to learn and to help battle some of their science teachers and whatnot in school. And the older kids that are here too, like me, I learned too. It's great, you know, when we think about the Almighty God, the creator of this universe, all creatures on this earth, what a wonderful planner, designer he is, even in some of the things he was explaining, how these dinosaurs got their balance and so on and so forth and had these things to be able to exist and do their function of what they needed to do in life. And, you know, not only did God create all these wonderful things and give us this wonderful earth and all of its wonders and so forth, he cared so much about us spiritually that he wants us to go to heaven to be with him forever and ever. And because of that, he sent his only begotten son to die on the cross for us so that we may be able to be saved. And we want to give you an invitation tonight. If there's anybody here that hasn't been obedient to the gospel, that hasn't been covered by blood's Christ and to receive his clothing, as Ryan was talking about, his covering of his righteousness and covered by his blood to wash away our sins. And you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, the Son of the living God, and that you're willing to repent of your sins and to turn from this world, turn to God, and turn from your sinful life, confessing before men so he'll confess you before the Father. And as Acts 2:38 says, those people asked on the day of Pentecost what they needed to do to be saved. And Peter replied, repent and be baptized. That word there is baptizo. It means to be dipped, plunged, immersed under the water, be buried under the water. You're burying your old man of sin under that water. And for what reason? To be able to receive the forgiveness of sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it says in Jesus' name to do that. And then after you become a Christian, then we need to live faithful, godly lives. If you're here and you need to make that decision tonight and you're ready to do that, the water's warm, we got robes. I'll be up here waiting. If anyone wants to come, we can take your confession and go back and change and baptize you in a matter of minutes. If you have questions about that, maybe you're not ready yet, please talk to me or Covey, the evangelist here. If you want to talk to Ryan, maybe somebody who invited you. We want to sit down and study with you in God's word and look a book, chapter, and verse of what the Bible teaches on these subject matters, because that's what's going to be judging us on the last day. So we're going to be standing, sing a hymn of invitation. If you need to be obedient to the gospel tonight, won't you please come as we sing? And we'll just be singing one verse.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
His teeth.
Stick around, visit. I'll take pictures, read some of these things, the placards and that they have. Check out the books that are out there. Bob will be back there. And Ryan also, if you have questions for him on a specific topic, great to be in the house of the Lord today. And, a little bit different from what we do from our normal revivals, but we've had a wonderful, blessed, great day and looking forward to the next three sessions. Let's close with prayer, and the Lord willing, we'll see most of you, or hopefully all of you, tomorrow evening at 7. Let's pray. Dear God, we love you. We praise you. You are so wonderful, dear God, and you provide us all things, both physically and spiritually. And we thank you that you did send your Son to die for us on Calvary's cross so that we could be saved and we could be able to come to heaven and be with you. We thank you for some of these topics that may be hard and sometimes maybe make us stumble as we think of dinosaurs. When did they exist? Did they exist 6,500 million years ago? Or were these things walking when man was on the earth? And if that's true, then what we understand of a young earth, probably 10,000 years or less, these animals were here and walked, and Adam and Eve and Noah and others, Enoch probably, and all these different people, and they're real. They have their bones. The Bible talks about them. Dive more into that as we move on here. Some of the names and terms that they give in the Bible for what we call dinosaurs. And these things are wonderful. A wonderful thing that you created. They probably wouldn't be able to function and exist today in our society and world the way that it is, but in the past they do exist. And, just help us to understand these things and to be able to defend your word and your truth. Be with us now as we meet. Give us safety on the highways and byways. We thank you that we can wear your name as Christians and help us to go out into the world and carry the banner of Christ high and to make a difference, being the salt and light we want us to be in this world, and to again tell others and share with them the good news of the gospel. We love you. We thank you for Jesus, our King and Lord. And we pray these things in his blessed name.
Glory, glory in the highest, glory to the Almighty, glory to the Lamb of God, glory to the living.